I'm out here standing in front of the Raceway service station in Georgia, Byron, Georgia. And I'm holding this winning ticket.
If you look right here, you can see the Mega Millions jackpot is...
145 million.
145 million.
Well, I yeah. hope you win.
Thank you, ma'am. My name is Curtis Sharp.
And my name is Sandra Camp.
Sandra Camp.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I won the New York lottery back in 1982. $5 million, yeah.
What are you doing trying to win some more money? You still don't have any of that money? I mean, Jesus.
That's gone.
Gone?
Yeah, the women took all of that.
I'm sorry to say, how many women did you let take?
Well, you know, it was quite a few.
All right, honey, there'll be plenty of room in there. I won't crowd you out.
Okay. All right, Miss
Jen. Do
what
you want to do.
Okay. Y'all have a best day.
Thank you.
Want to hear my message?
Hello, this is Richard Needham. I'm here in the car with Curtis. We're crawling along somewhere outside Gainesville. I wanted to find out when the races are at the dog track so that we could schedule that.
But you got everybody here got gray hair, right?
What's the matter with you?
Yo.
That's Richard. How you been?
Are we all white? We're not all white? You got me fooled. I don't know. I thought we were white and Jewish. Maybe we're not.
So how you doing?
Hanging in. Same old long
Yeah,
considering, you know, the only muscle left is this thing over here. And that's
it works, huh?
I'm not sure that works either.
This is Johnny Carson, myself, and my ex-wife over there. And there's Sammy Davis. And look how nice you look.
You know, we walked in on Regent's show one day.
Yeah.
Patrick Ewing.
Yeah, that's right. He's sitting. He looks short.
Hello, there's our friend.
Yeah, that's Tony Bennett.
Yeah. Oh, here we go.
Who are you? What do you got there? Look, you're in Ripley's Believe It or Not. I said, wow. And there's Larry Hagman.
That was a big time then. I mean, Dallas was almost done.
Yeah, that was, yeah, that's right.
He just got shot.
Yeah.
He looks like he's a little shy.
This photo, we was taking at Yankee Stadium. We were there, and we were throwing the ball out, and the whole world loved us. And they started go, like, what was that, wave, Curtis? The whole place, and the players themselves, Dave Winfield, I think, the outfielder, they stopped playing ball. And Phil Rizzuto said, don't be frightened, don't be scared. It's only the two lotto winners. They're waving to people. And all of a sudden I hear, boo, boo. I says, they're booing us. He says, no, they're calling Lou, Lou. I says, wow, what an experience. Phil Rizzuto was there, it was funny.
By simply buying a dollar lottery ticket, Lou Eisenberg and Curtis Sharp not only became multimillionaires, they also became instant celebrities. While they still have their memories, today, the money is all gone.
This is my place. See what the hurricane did over here? Knocked this TV out and killed the window outside. Now, I got a lot of memories. What's the word?
You keep everything under the bed?
No, those posters. I figure they're safer there.
What are those bags in the corner? What's in those?
Those are tickets I call, you know, for... It's part of my gambling experiences. I hold them in case they want to bother me of you know, losing money. If I win something, I can deduct it. When I won the lottery, I came out. I was fine. Hey, how you doing? I was able to talk. I was able to make eye contact. Before that, I took this Mickey Mouse job putting in light bulbs, you know, because I couldn't make eye contact and I couldn't talk to people.
I don't want to get personal and ask what you were making before.
You may.
But
$225 a week. $225.
So you've gone to almost $2,000 a week or something like that.
From bulbs to financial success.
Yeah.
I did it my way. I don't know.
It was just nice traveling around. I was in Aruba. I was in Puerto Rico. I was all over.
Me and my wife would get in an argument. She'd say, I wish you had never won the lottery and stuff like that. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I bought this little beer joint, you know? And man, I used to leave that place so drunk, I didn't know which way I was going. And so I was laying up there one night in the bed, and the Lord came to me. I couldn't sleep. I just couldn't rest. And it came to me, and he told me, he said, "I want you to preach my word." I go out to all the jails and the prisons. I met one in the shop down there, working, got a good job. And he said, "Don't you remember me, Mr. Sharp?" He said, "I was under your teaching." And he took heed to it. That's why he got a job down there. You know what I'm saying? Not to me, but the word of God. Our pastor sent us out everywhere, to the missions, the jails, the senior citizen homes, everywhere, you know? And I love it.
This is your character.
Thank you so much and good luck.
The winning tickets.
There we go, baby. Winning.
Hey, you. 20, what, 24 years, 22 years later?
At least. Me, it's 23 or 4. Good luck, Clarence.
Good luck to you.
Imagine taking an ant and putting a little colored marker on it. You then take that ant and put it with a whole bunch of other ants and fill a football field. You would put them around 10 ants per square inch. That gives them a little bit of room to move around. You playing the lottery is equivalent to walking into that football stadium, walking out onto the field, and putting your finger down once. If your finger hits that marked ant, you've won the jackpot. That's what odds of 80 million to one mean.
When a person wins a lottery, hopefully they'll have good help and they'll have some professional management involved in it, and they'll do some good things with it. But you know, you and I, we can't dictate that to a person. There's no question about it. That's their money.
Drum roll, please. We have, I'm happy to say, in West Virginia today, the largest Powerball winner in history. From Putnam County, Mr. Andrew Jack Whitaker, right here. We want to present to you this check for $314 million.
The very first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go home. I'm going to sit down and make out three checks to three pastors for 10% of this check. That's the very first thing I'm going to do. I have 25 people laid off right now at Christmas. I want more work so I can put them back to work. I don't like them being off work. It's gonna really excite my granddaughter and my daughter. They're the ones that's gonna be spending the money.
He called me at 9 o'clock in the morning and he's like, "You need to get dressed up because I won the lottery." And I was like, "No, you didn't. You swear?
As promised, Jack Whitaker was generous. He gave nearly $20 million to three churches, rehired his employees, and he gave Brandy an allowance of $400 a day.
She had a yellow Corvette, she had a Hummer, she had an Escalade,
and
an Eclipse.
I'd have 40 cars. I'd have a car every day of the year.
I think four with two less, in my opinion. But she had the top dollar four cars.
He had a $350,000 Rolls Royce Phantom sitting in his garage.
Yes, he did. It was badass. Fur carpet.
$355,000.
Black fur carpet. I sit in it. I got started, that's all. I got started.
Even though he was generous, Jack soon faced an endless number of legal allegations and lawsuits. But nothing would prepare him for what happened on the night of September 24th, 2004.
Well, my name is Jimmy Tribble, and you know, I'm the father of Jesse Tribble. And Jesse is the young man that died in Jack Whitaker's home in Scott Depot. And there was no adult supervision at that home. There was nobody there supervising the environment. And we believe that he was negligent in the death of Jesse, my son. And that's really what the lawsuit's all about. is some accountability.
He was a golfer. And if you go out through there when they mow, he'd take and dig him a little hole and put a can in it, see? And that was his, you know, he'd putt or play golf. He'd fix it up. Because I used to tell him and Jamie that when I was gone, that someday they'd have this and not to sell it. And Jamie and them, that's what they said. They said they'd make it into a golf course. But they liked to... They were typical teenagers. They liked to come down and stay for a while, and then they liked to go back to the, you know, back to the city. And that's why when he stayed here, I would take him over to visit, you know, his friends. Cause I have, if I had a party, sometimes I'd crawl out of here at 1:30, 2 o'clock in the morning to go get him.
Jesse worked here about 2 months. When he was going to summer school, I was letting him come in and do part-time work. He was actually doing the dipping back there, and he was running the lathe, and you know, he was doing a lot of stuff, making bats for us.
Oh, I did times of drink. I mean, not like I do now, but I mean, and she didn't really do anything. She just hung out with me and him. We just go to the mall and stuff, and just go have fun.
Brandy's shopping sprees would go for thousands and thousands of dollars. Cars for whoever wanted one, drugs for whoever wanted them, numerous amounts of clothes, shoes, jewelry. Perfume, jewelry.
People just started using her.
And he was supposedly getting $500 or $800 a week to be her chauffeur. So as a parent, you know, I've got an 18-year-old son who's being paid that kind of money to drive her around in any make of a brand new automobile. There were about 6 or 7 of them she had access to. And I'm sure the drugs were rampant. You know, I pleaded with him over the phone to come home and get out of there. And so finally, he came home late one night at the house, and he was crying and bawling about 2 a.m. And he said Brandy and Mimi had dumped him in Winfield and left him. I made him lay down on the couch and had a little talk with him and just told him he had to clean up. He got away from Brandy Bragg. He was done. And then a night went by and he never did pop up. And I called his mom. She hadn't seen him. And then Friday morning, my brother come over here and told me that they had found a body in Jack Whitaker's house. And that body was Jesse. And so we were in total shock. Here he had got away from that environment and left it. And how in the world did he end up over there? I don't know.
Their examination began at 8:30 a.m. and was finished by 9:15. It says he died as a result of acute combined toxicity of drugs. No prescription access to any of these drugs is documented, and a cocaine metabolite detected in the descendant's urine is consistent with the smoking of cocaine. The circumstances surrounding the death and the investigative postmortem findings indicate the matter of death is accident.
Our top story, the Whitaker's run of bad luck turns tragic. Good evening, everyone. I'm Laura Bager.
And I'm Rick Lord. Thanks for joining us. State troopers found Brandy Bragg's body in Scary Creek in Putnam County this afternoon. Investigators say it was dumped near a church. Bragg's body has been taken to the state medical examiner's office for an autopsy.
This search has been going on for 2 weeks now. As you said, this is not the result the family was hoping for. I'll show you where Brandy Bragg was found, right behind this red van.
When she was missing, Jack called me to go find her. I knew where she was. I
could find her everywhere.
You knew that she was in Scary Creek?
Yeah, that's where I live at. That's where I live.
She was at Brandy Bragg's house. I live a mile from
there. And she was there when I went there beating on the door, and I guess she was already dead.
In the back of the van, and then I backed up and slammed into the back of the van. And that's haunted me every day, and I was that close, but so far away.
Yeah, and 20 days later, we found out that's where she was.
And I still had to be on my truck. I still had to be on my truck with that.
So,
what are y'all doing?
Trying to kill
me, I think.
Smoking. secondhand cancer is the best.
So, I mean, there are lots of different things to talk about here. I mean, is methadone an increasing problem around here?
They're shutting down. Oh, God, yeah. I can say I've never done it, so, I mean, I don't. But they're shutting methadone clinics down. They're only keeping five of them open. They're not reopening any methadone clinics. There's a paper in there. There's a paper in the kitchen.
Yeah, they're saying that helps people. It's to help people.
It actually makes people.
It's a worse addiction. It's another addiction. And when they cut them off, their methadone, they gotta find another drug to take care of that methadone. That methadone is
stronger than any drug you can buy on the street.
But I mean, people are taking it just.
People are signing up to the methadone clinic so they can
get a bus,
get a cheaper bus,
and get the federal government to pay for it.
When he won,
she just
looked like a normal girl, blonde hair. You know, she wasn't overweight, she wasn't underweight. You know, she looked healthy. And by the time last time I saw her, I thought she, you know, was pretty much dead.
There's a lot of drugs in Taze Valley now that wasn't when I was in school. I mean, there's drugs here that wasn't here. I mean, you know, I guess the crystal and heroin and stuff like that. I mean, it wasn't around when we was in school. I mean, and the kids got a lot more to get into. And, you know, when you got that much backing and you got an allowance of I don't know what you got a week. I mean, you know, there ain't nothing else to do around here. There's nothing to do here. I mean, if you got a lot of money and a lot of time on your hands, there's, you know, just trouble to get into. I mean, that's all there is.
I mean, West Virginia, you have to realize, is a low-income state. Here, your median income is way below the national average. What we call middle-class working people here are near the poverty level in the rest of the states.
What happened to this town and all the people in it after Jack won that money?
People started hating him.
People hated him, begged him, begged him, begged him. You'd see him out. 25 people would
swarm like a damn actor.
Yeah.
But that's why he went from having 40 people in his company to 400 people in a big company. His company expanded because he wanted to help everybody. He put a foundation out there to help everybody.
Everybody took his
time. He wanted to help and help and help and help. That's why he's in the situation he is now.
My honest opinion, if he wouldn't have won the lottery, those two kids wouldn't be dead. I think he'd still be here.
Do you think that's the opinion of most people around here?
Yeah. Yeah, I do.
Okay, our daily bread. Forgive us the trespasses, and we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not in temptation, deliver us from evil. Now is the King, power, and the glory forever. Amen.
All right, here we go, man. 24, is that right? 24. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. Come on now.
A lot of these 17, 18-year-old kids running around here today, they're having a tough time. They haven't figured things out, and a lot of them have tough home lives. And, you know, I coach, and I just believe I've got a rule. I don't kick any of my players off of the team. When I have a kid that skips a class or he gets caught drinking or something, he's disciplined for that. And he has to make up the missed practices, and he has to do extra work around the ball field and show up on Saturday morning with a shovel and a rake to stay on the baseball team. But that's a lot better off than kicking somebody off of a team and giving them a straight path to jail or doing drugs or being dead.
I would wish my worst enemy for their son or daughter to die.
So you're a religious man, money's the root of all evil. Sure are you that, you know, this money's not going to corrupt you and drive wedges between the people that are close to you.
This is not the first money I've had. I'm a very generous person, and I've always been blessed. I've always tithed, and I've always been blessed. I just keep, when I give it away, it just keep coming back.
To this day, 37 million Americans in poverty, 46 million without health insurance. So it's in that context of that economic insecurity, that job loss, that lotteries arose as an alternative income source for states. And importantly, it became a new opportunity.
We're seeing more and more of these businesses in this city and around the United States. It's a business that'll give you payroll advances or cashier checks. They'll take a hefty percentage of that, but they'll help you out with it. So while you come in to get that kind of help, the state of Ohio will also give you some help. They'll give you a chance to escape this economic insecurity by selling you a lottery ticket, as many as you want to buy. So this is your chance to get some petrol money and also to maybe tomorrow become a millionaire. But this is your ticket out of this neighborhood and maybe to Park Avenue. So who knows your lottery sign? So I thought it was a great sign and just wondered how many people who come in, you know, to get checks, cash and stuff may end up buying lottery tickets.
A lot.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, but I don't think I'm allowed to be on camera or anything. So.
Yeah.
But yeah, a lot.
On December 30th, 2004, the Mega Millions jackpot reached $162 million. Alicia Battle filed a police report that the winning ticket had fallen out of her handbag in the convenience store parking lot. This sent people scrambling through the snow hoping to find the winning ticket. But eventually, Mr. and Mrs. Jameson came forward as the rightful winners.
Oprah Show called me and asked me could I do an interview and say I made a mistake, but I lied. And I told him, no, I'm not gonna do it. Like, what? I'm not gonna do it. I'm not gonna say that. I did not lie. I did not make a mistake because media speculated and took it to where they wanted it to go.
I did lose the ticket. I knew the numbers. I knew everything. I knew the time because they were questioning me in the police station.
Where did the story come from? You were posed for pictures with your empty handbag saying that you'd lost the ticket.
I actually thought I did have the ticket in my purse. And we had the ticket together.
Who did?
And me and Mr. Jameson.
You gave him
$2.
$2.
Yeah.
Did he buy the lottery ticket?
He went and purchased it, yeah.
That was actually the winning ticket.
That was the winning ticket.
What you're telling me is not true, it's not honest. And trying to make your boxing career look like that is honest, the whole thing comes across as you're trying to avoid something.
Well, I guess, you know, I just probably just didn't want to really, you know, I would be honest and talk about it with you, but I didn't know if you wanted the details. You are so right. It is behind me. Definitely is behind me. I mean, I can't bring it back. I wouldn't even want to bring it that day back because it was horrible. So tell me, what is it? Tell me exactly what is it that you want to know, and I'll be honest with you from that point, from this point on when we talk right now.
Did you lie about winning the ticket?
Yes, I lied about winning the ticket.
I was a tough kid in school. I would take it from my brothers when they should have been taking it from me. I was the fighter, like, in the family. My kids are supportive. My mom, my sister, but my daughter is my biggest fan. I mean, I have a lot of fans around here. That's why I want to make it, and bring something back to the community. You know, do something for people, little kids. I can make millions of dollars. I just gotta get it a little chip at a time. God sent things and you can't see it. He sent things to you and you can't see it, but it's there. So you have to keep doing what you're doing.
I tried to fight to keep my job. They didn't want me because of the, you know, what happened with the lottery.
It interrupted Michael Jackson. And Michael Jackson was like, at the time, it was like the main story. Here I come across, I interrupt all that. You know, I mean, it actually interrupted, it knocked his story from number one to number two.
It turned into a monster.
And my mom would pray for me. I know she would. She was really supportive. I would go out on the street and I would put on sunglasses, and I don't care what I did,
And I normally don't wear, you know, all the makeup. So I tried one day just to put on, you know, more makeup. One lady saw me and she knew exactly through all that, through the wig, through the glasses, through the lipstick. She's like, I know who you are. You know what? You don't have to do that. She said, you are who you are. You don't have to change. You have a distinguished look. Be who you are. And my mom always said, hold your head up high. So I put all that together and now I'm holding my head up high. I'm not gonna look back. My mom always tell me, don't look down and die, look up and live. Me and my husband was out to dinner and this gentleman came up to me. He had said, I saw you on TV, you look really strong. We're looking for a fighter for Layla.
I guess when I was smaller, I used to always like to fight, you know, get into it with other people, fight. Me and my friend, I don't know. It was just that I wanted to show up my skills. I wanted to show my karate skills. So.
Always, she wanted to fight. She wanted to make people do stuff. When she was coming up.
I'll have a friend bump into somebody, then I'll jump and intervene. And like, okay, I'm going to handle this. Then we both, you know, it was just fun. We'll see some. We picked out the biggest kid in the school to start a fight with, and it wasn't a girl. It was always a guy. I'll make her bump into him, and he'll, would you bump? Then that's when we get into the brawl. You know, start brawling.
She go on you. For what? I don't know. That was just her way.
Mm-hmm. I'm like, stubborn. I'll give it a nice one.
She didn't figure that nobody could whoop her.
I still don't believe her.
That's where she was.
What do we have there?
Right here, you know, I'm boxing, as you know that. I'm boxing. Also, I'm designing day wear. You can wear it with jeans, however you want to fix it up. It's nice. It's a bustier. It's got day wear. Here's one of my designs, and here's my other one with the denim. This is my house I'm gonna have built. This is it right here.
Oh, show that to the camera.
Oh yeah, this is the house that I'm going to have built.
That's dead.
You heard it, he wanna see it, Daddy. No. He wanna see it.
Let me see it too.
You can see it after I'm done, Daddy. Why are you acting like you acting?
I can't do that.
Shit. Let him do it.
Oh, he got the, I didn't know if
that. Yeah, that's what I was trying to tell you.
He showed on the picture. Oh, I thought you were showing. I was wrong.
So tell us what that is again.
This is the house that I'm going to, actually this is where my son lives, in Bahrain. But this is the house that I'm going to have built. Once my boxing profession. Isn't that beautiful?
Well, you can see it through that thing?
Oh yeah.
That's where I was. I didn't know she was
short. Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's a nice house.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I first met Alisa, she came into the gym. The gym was full. And another guy brought in that was supposed to be our manager. So he said, Ron, you know who this is? And I really didn't know, because she had been on the news. I'm like, no, I don't know. I mean, should I know who she is? And he was like, man, that's Lisa Ballo. I said, well, okay, pleased to meet you, Lisa Ballo. He said, well, I'm going to be a conditioning coach, and I want you to train on boxing. I said, are you serious? And he said, yeah. So I said, well, okay, well. So she came back the next day, and we got a chance to sit down and talk, and then I started training on just on basic fundamentals. And while she was in the gym, quite honest with you, all the fighters, everybody in there was like, what is she doing here? Why is she wasting her time? They was laughing at her. You know what I mean? They was literally laughing. You know, then over a period of time, her dedication and her seriousness showed, because she hasn't missed a beat in like 2 years. I mean, it's very rare that she doesn't come to the gym. It's very rare, and then she's very teachable because she's always there to learn.
It was the money. It was the amount of money, and I was like, it was really close to home. I just didn't get anything out of it except all the negative.
I told him that I lost a ticket.
I got, you know, first financial job, jobless.
What machine? And
you know, all I really had was, you know, really I just had my kids. On the police report, I told them that I lost a ticket. It was in my purse, it must have fell out, and I gave them numbers, what machine, and what time it was. I was accurate on everything.
How did you know that?
I hope you believe me. I took a guess.
I'm just a fan, that's all. That's all. I came to see the champ. What's up, Ron?
What's going on, you good?
Like the whole world was against this one person. I mean, you got millions and billions of people in the world, and it's like they were all against me. And the monster is gone.
If you think back to early humans, they lived very risky lives. There was no guarantee of making it through the day. There was no guarantee of finding dinner. You were just as likely to end up as dinner, as find something to eat for dinner. And I think at that time, humans, the human brain, the human body was really attuned to risk. Today, most people lead lives that are pretty safe. We're not likely to be attacked by predators suddenly. We have a reasonably good chance of finding something to eat during the day. We're not going to starve if we don't go down and hunt and kill an animal that's five times as big as us, but that has huge razor-sharp fangs. So I think people don't have that kind of risk in their everyday lives anymore, and maybe playing the lottery is a way to get that kind of thrill, saying, while I'm waiting for these numbers to be called, maybe my life will be different. You know, maybe tomorrow's the last day of going to work.
Imagine taking a dollar bill, putting an X on one side. You're then going to lay down dollar bills side by side all the way from San Francisco to New York. Playing the lottery is equivalent to walking along from San Francisco to New York, picking a dollar bill at random. You turn it over. If you've got the dollar bill with the cross on it, you've won the jackpot.
If you believe that there are forces out there that are superior to humans, that control the cosmos, how do we know what they want us to do? Well, there's a couple different ways. Someone can tell you what the gods, for lack of a better term, want us to do, but that person might have a stake in it. So you need to find someone who has no stake in the matter, who can tell you what the gods want. Well, an inanimate rock or twig has no stake in anything. So the idea is, okay, we will roll this rock, we will roll this bone, we'll see what the gods want us to do. And if the bone lands this side up, we'll go north. If it ends that side up, we'll go south. That is really the roots of the gambling idea. People inherently like to make sense of things. We don't like randomness. We try to put faces and patterns. You know, I think part of that is where superstition comes into play, where people say, well, if I go through this ritual, then I've got a better chance of winning. You know, if I don't go through this ritual, I've blown it. You know, because the one time I didn't do the ritual, I remember I lost. You know, and when I did do the ritual, I lost, but maybe it's because I didn't do it in the right way, or I didn't do it with enough feeling. So I think superstition really plays a part in that, because it's a way that people try to control what they can't control, and that is the unknown.
You know how to spell seven?
Yeah.
Spell it and drop the S.
E-V-E-N.
Which spells what?
Even.
Did you ever flash on that before in your life?
I don't think so.
No, I mean, did you ever take the time to notice that seven is even with an S? Yet it's odd. Now, 11? Spell that and drop the E-L. What does that say?
Even.
Did you ever notice that the only two numbers in numerology that spell odd or even is 7 and 11? And yet, they spell even, and what are they? They're odd. No big deal? Well, I dwell on stuff like that.
On March 7th, 1992, Dennis Sanfilippo purchased 11 tickets at exactly 11 p.m. The next day, he won $32 million.
It's been said, if your instrument or your axe has never been in a pawn shop, it can't play the blues. That's funny, but it's the truth.
Okay, this is a kettle that we used in roofing, and what we do is this would be level, and this lid opens up, and you fill it full of hot tar, which comes in 100-pound kegs, and then it melts, then it. You take it out there and get it up on the roof and throw it into these carts, and you literally mopped the stuff on and rolled out felt and hot mopped them together, and then that made your roof.
One thing is, when you're up on a roof, you got to be careful you don't slip and fall 20 or 30 or 40 feet.
When it comes out of that mop cart, it's 450 to 500 degrees. So just one little spot of that on your skin just, like I say, melts you right down to the bone.
When you're on the ground, you gotta make sure when they're putting that hot tire up on the roof, it don't fall on you. There's a lot of danger in roofing, and that's what Dennis was, a roofer.
It's a really enlightenment to go now, especially when it's 100 degrees, and see these guys up there and me going, man, if I hadn't won this money, that's probably where I'd be at right now.
Often I wonder how long it's been since I saw my old friend. Somehow I know before my life ends, we'll meet again. That's a song I wrote for John Lee Hooker. I met Dennis at Zapp's, and
he said, I have your album, Let's Talk About the Blues, which features Buddy Miles and Elvin Bishop and John Lee Hooker. He said, how come you haven't cut a second album? I said, oh, that's simple. I don't have the money. He said, is that all you need? I said, yeah. He said, you got the songs? I said, yeah, I got the songs. He said, you got the singers to sing them? I said, yeah. He said, well, here's my card. Come to my office. He was working for a roofing company. So I was at his office the next morning, and he laid out money. I picked it up, and I said, what do you want me to sign, Dennis? He said, Deacon, the way I operate is if a man doesn't have a word, we could sign a stack of papers that big, and it wouldn't mean nothing. He said, a handshake is okay with me. So we shook hands, and that's when I started on the album Making Blues History.
Let me know when you're ready.
I'm ready. This is Dennis Ampalipo.
Ready? Yeah. Okay, now.
This is Dennis Ampalipo with One in a Million on the Bikers Inner Circle Underground Radio Show. This week, being our seventh show, I take pride in thanking all you listeners for your support and making it happen.
That was good, but you gotta keep rolling.
Yeah, let's do it.
We can do it in sections if you want.
Yeah, but now it's easier. You don't have to slice it in.
Yeah,
okay.
You do it like this every time. Just relax. While you're doing that, I ought to let you hear the. You want to hear the music I wrote for the Discovery Channel song?
Yeah, go ahead, do that.
The Gypsy song? Yeah. Right here. Really a gypsy, so I'm gonna say she rides like a thief in the night. She can break them down and build them right, you know, that kind of thing, right? Travels fast and long. That's why I wrote this here song.
This week's show, being our seventh show of the season, I take pride in thanking all of you listeners for making this a reality come true, for Big Seven and Charlie Brechtel Band and everybody that's been working on this. It makes me, nope.
That was good though. You want to keep that first part?
All right.
Or you want to do it over again?
I'll do it over again. Here, how's this one?
Wait, let me tell him how I met you.
Oh.
Okay, I was playing at a little bar, and he come up with his roof and hat and tar all over his pants. And I was supposed to meet this big promoter that does bands, right? This bike guy that I knew, Gino. He goes, oh, yeah. So Dennis comes walking up. I go, what do you mean? He goes, well, I do bands, but I'm a roofer. I go, okay, that's cool. So next thing we started talking, and I go, hey, well, I got this idea to do a blues show called the South Bay Blues Awards. And matter of fact, that's the poster on the wall right here behind Dennis.
Right here.
Look, that was the first show we did.
That's right before I won the lottery.
Right before he won the lotto. And Dennis goes, well, what are you talking about? I go, well, I can do this blues show, right? And this guy wants to give me this big building that holds like 5,000 people for $250 for the night because he don't think I can get anybody in it on a Sunday. So on a Sunday, we packed it. And we did a blues award show with Deacon Jones. And John Lee Hooker showed up because I just, you know, I started playing with him. And everybody was thinking me and Dennis couldn't do it because he's a roofer, I was a nightclub guy, nobody even knew who we were, right? And it turned into a, next year we had Bo Diddley, Albert Collins, I mean, but anyway, we did it with roofing money and pennies, and I made the red beans and rice, and that was our buffet. See where it says Cajun buffet? Well, Cajun buffet was me making red beans and rice. This is how much my life changed from it. Check it out. Look, see this right here? This is me and B.B. King. You know how that happened? From Dennis. Dennis hooked that whole thing up for us to go on tour with B.B. King. Okay, I was like, what, 20? How old was I there, Dennis? Like 30, 28?
Something like that.
Huh. And look, I'm on the road, Good Time Charlie with B.B. King.
Do you believe in karma? What do you think?
Oh, yeah. What goes around comes around? Well, for one thing, I believe in God. You know, and well, like miracles have happened in my life. The very first one was when I was 5 years old, I couldn't walk. I used to crawl around the house. And I'd crawl up to the window and look out the window at the kids running up and down the street playing. And my parents took me to one doctor after another, and nobody knew what it was. Nobody knew why I couldn't walk. So finally, my parents heard about this faith healer down in Connersville, Indiana. And they drove me down there to him, and the faith healer blessed this jar of water and gave it to my parents and said, have him drink a glass of water every day for a week. And every day he drinks it, say the Lord's Prayer. And my parents did that. And the eighth day, I was walking. That's why every time at any of my shows, there's someone sitting there in a wheelchair, I walk up and give them a CD or a t-shirt. And if they, most of people say, oh, thank you, Deacon. And if anyone ever says, why are you doing this? I'll tell them the story. Once upon a time, I couldn't walk, and a miracle happened.
It was a Thursday. Dennis was pacing my front room floor, and he said, Deacon, I know things are going slow, but I need you to hang in there, because I feel something really big is getting ready to happen.
My truck had broke down, so I had to make money, and what I do is I photograph the mother lode, the history, and I sell it in the gift shops. So I had to get up here, so I walk. I just start walking, and if somebody gives me a ride, great. If they don't, I keep walking. When I got to Farmington, I sat on the rail as you leave town, and he came along in this old car, this old hippie-looking guy. I first said, I don't think I want to get in the car with this guy, you know? And he looked at me like, I don't know if I want to pick you up. Once I got in the car and we started driving, he asked where I was going, and I said, I'm going up to the mother lode to had some pictures to sell this picture. And now this is the part I don't know if I'm supposed to tell, where we rolled the joint. Anyway, needless to say, I got pretty stoned. So we drove into Murphy's. He goes, you know, I'll tell you, I bought some lottery tickets today, and I think I'm going to win tonight because I feel lucky today.
Do you know what day I bought my ticket? March the 7th of 92. March 7th, 92. 9 and 2 is what?
11.
It was a leap year. Has one extra day. In where?
February.
What's the day?
28, 29, 11.
I bought 11 tickets. At exactly 11 o'clock. When I bought the tickets, right, I told the guy, hey, can you do me a favor, man? Don't put shows in till that clock exactly hits 11 o'clock.
He went in and got the numbers and came out, and me and his son, Dennis, were sitting in the car, and we were in the front seat, and he started looking at him, and he goes, that's a bunch of them. And he went to this other one, and he goes, because they're not the same, you know, and he looked, and he kept going, He goes, I won. And I'm going, yeah, right. Joke time here. He goes, look. I looked. And I said, son of a bitch. This guy just won, how much? $15 million. Well, there goes that, friend.
Come Sunday morning, that's when he called me and said, are you sitting down? I said, yeah. He said, Deacon, I just won the lottery. I said, Dennis, come on, don't tease me like that. Why did you call? He said, Deacon, listen to me carefully. I just won the lottery. So there it is Sunday morning. I'm starting to wake up now, you know. I said, Dennis, you sound serious.
He called me up and he goes, Charlie, he goes, you ain't gonna believe this. And meanwhile, while he's telling me this, my ex-old lady was leaving me, packing up, taking a suitcase. She's had it with the musician life, right? And I go, please don't leave, you know. And she goes, I'm out of here. And the phone rang. And it's Dennis. He goes, I just won the lotto. I go, you won the lotto? Man, she started putting her stuff back in the drawer, right? So he goes, I won $16 million. And I go, are you kidding me? I go, Dennis, this ain't a good time right now, man. Lucy's leaving me. It's a weird trip. He goes, no, seriously. So then I hang up the phone. I go, wow, Dennis won the lottery. She goes, ah, yeah, right. But she still started putting the clothes up, right? So then he calls back, and he goes, Charlie, I didn't win $16 million. I go, I knew it. As soon as I said that, she started grabbing her shit, putting it back in the thing, right? So check it out. He goes, I won $32 million. I checked the ticket twice. The clothes, the bed was made. Hey, Dennis, am I lying? And look, so he goes, come on down to Sacramento. I rented the whole top thing out, okay? I went and opened up the door to leave, and the car had everybody in it. My brother-in-law, my sister, my wife. Hey, look, come on, let's go. We'll take you there.
Why don't you explain what you have up here? Just for good luck or something?
Yeah, I always surround myself with angels.
Dennis has always been wondering, who was it that was his so-called lucky charm? Because he figured he didn't do it all by himself. Somebody entered. Well, Freddie King used to make this statement. Everyone that enters your life brings you good luck or bad luck. Everybody. What you got to be able to do is distinguish between the two.
The best thing that he's done, and it's been a life-changing experience for me, is that I got a 12-year-old daughter that I just got custody of because her mom dropped her off or couldn't handle her no more. And by Dennis, you know, stepping up to the plate and making me step up to the plate, you know, to take care of this little girl, he gave us a house, I mean, to live in, and said, don't worry about nothing, because I was stressed. All of a sudden, I got a 12-year-old girl I got to raise. I'm 54 years old, and he says, don't worry about nothing. This is my daughter, Michaela Reynoso, my pride and joy. She just made honor roll. She made honor roll again.
When I met George in, I think, 75 or 6 or 7, somewhere around there, I gave him a gold nugget ring. Huh? Was it a diamond ring I gave?
A diamond ring with black on it.
Oh, okay. But I gave him. This isn't. Oh, you put your diamond. Oh, I had a diamond in it though, right?
Yeah.
But I gave it to George. And I think that kind of put some whammy on of what happened to me.
Like I was saying, me and my wife has been living here in Macon, payments to this lady that we was buying a house from. So she gave us a 90-day notice to come up with $80,000 cash. Dennis wound up buying it for X amount of money and just left me here and kept the rent like it is. So he's a good guy. So I keep it up, maintain it, and I fix everything on it. It's an old house, but yeah, we like it here. It's like our own piece of heaven here.
45,
huh? Wow. That is so cool how it works.
Wow.
Jim Reeves, the gentleman. I like this kind of music. You know what name is too? Welcome to my world. This from a guy for $400. It's never gonna work, so I fixed it and I got it. You fixed it yourself? Yeah. The counter was 9999. I'm still stuck on that, so I just released it. Program it.
When I won the lottery, I lived and continued to live in the same house I was living in before I won the lottery. And the reason why was I loved that house. Ever since I first came up here, I had a saying that every day is Saturday and every night is Friday night up here. There's only Friday nights and Saturdays.
He had long hair and he had that kind of rebellious look. And it's big, tall, dark, and handsome. That was 20 years ago when we met. Before he won the lottery, he was helping around the house and rubbing my feet, giving me back massages. Even when he was working and not had won the lottery yet, he came home just on weekends. So we were not used to spending every day together. And we both probably had temptations for that reason. And little infidelity on both sides. So that contributed to it. And the money made that easier to happen.
And like I say, I've never been married. I'm 54, so. I'll be 108 in 54 more years. And if I am, I probably am still gonna say, never been married. Because I always believed if I ever did get married, it'd be forever.
I know what he's been through. He's been through the thing of helping his one of his best friends and the guy turning around and stabbing him in the back.
You're seeing lottery people now. You know what they go through. Boy, more bad than good, I tell you. I mean, people come out of the woodworks. They want to be your friend. Trust me. Don't worry, trust me. That's what I tell all kids. Don't deal with anybody that says trust me or don't worry. If you look it up in your dictionary, it says fuck you.
Right, when you want.
We'll put it this way. I have numerous homes up here.
Yeah.
Well, guess what? Who do you think puts the roofs on? And guess what? Guess what? I like cutting firewood. So guess what happens when people drive by and see me cutting firewood? It pisses them off. God damn. And guess what now? I drove my Viper here. Well, as I drive my Viper here, guess what people do? Oh, hey, look. There's that guy won all the money. Yeah, what a show off that some bitch is, driving that Viper and shit. Well, guess what? I never drive it. I like driving my old Ford pickup. So guess what happens when I drive that? Hey, look, there's that guy. Got all that money, right? Driving that shitty truck. But I like reading about history, so when I got this place, I went into the history books and checked out who McKinley was, who was really a, must have been an incredible man because he was married to a totally invalid wife who, which is really sad because at the times when they would have big dinners at the White House, he had to personally hand feed her. Yeah, this is Jenny Lind, and this was originally mined in the late 1800s, early 1900s, with the presidential land patent McKinley did. What we're doing is we're bringing in a screening plant here and going to be making gravel for the salmon and steelhead, and then it'll leave a pile of a quarter, smaller than a quarter inch down, and that's the piles that we're going to be reclaiming the gold and gold dust. We'll be taking these tailings down to ground level here too. A lot of this rock they use for the J. Paul Getty Museum in Malibu. They used a lot of, they came and got a lot of this big rock for waterfalls that they made. But it has to be like hand-picked. Put it into baskets on a pellet.
This is all poison oak when you go through it, Richard. Hell yeah, there's a lot of money in these biggins.
Well, we got an order for 55,000 tons of the salmon scrum.
For the good deal.
For everything, and even here.
Oh, yeah, yeah, huh?
It's like a $600,000 order.
Plus, we're helping nature.
Yeah, that's what I was saying.
Because I want me some fish.
Well, plus, they're taking quarter-inch rock above. It's going to leave a pile of smaller than quarter-inch to dirt.
And so that's bedrock.
Base. That's where we're going to be the...
The gold. Yeah. And that rope base. Yeah. $6 billion in gold? I'm ready.
Is that what it's going to be?
What? Billions.
Billions?
Well, if... It could get into that implication if this gold is that... I mean, there's the recovery system works like it's supposed to.
This ain't me making this up. I mean, why 25th letter of the alphabet is designated in numerology as 7? Y2K, right? Which is Y is...
7.
K is...
7 or 11. Yeah.
So what if they really were seven saying, gee, what a coincidence, the 7 to 11, which was total what? Bullshit, right?
You go to bed dreaming up this shit.
No, I don't dream this shit up. It's just, I didn't make that up.
I know, but I mean, do you go to bed thinking this all the time? All these fucking numbers going through your head.
Well, hold it. What do you mean, making the shit up? I'm not making shit up. It's
no,
right there, isn't it?
George was the only one that was allowed to drink out of an original glass here. And do you know what I'm talking about, George? Or did you forget already? Anyway, the original glass, which I said way back then, I said, you should put those glass in a case there, man.
Get rid of them.
No, they finally broke the last original glass here. But up until the time he got to drink out of that glass at the original price, which
original
was what?
Shot glass.
Yeah, well, how much would they charge you, 35 cents or some shit?
Yeah.
And this is years before they won the lottery. I used to get pissed off, man. I said, that glass, the remaining glass from the original bar here should be put in the case, which if it would, it'd be in my bar now, but it's gone now. And guess what? It'll never be here.
A little tiny symbol. So you didn't actually get a shot. You got a half shot. Because you put that in a normal shot glass, so you got a half shot. So you got only a half shot when you came to the saloon. I wanted to get shot completely.
Yeah, better one.
You've been a good buddy for over
that's
20 years.
One.
Blake, you always called me son, I always called you dad. And that was for real,
you're
right?
Like
was that bullshit or what? Was that bullshit?
No, it's no bullshit,
no,
it's
isn't.
A fact. That's a fact, whether you want to accept it or not.
I do, I'm proud of it, man.
Thank you very much. Now, that's a real compliment, Dennis.
And he used to be a dance instructor. This guy used to boogie around here with all the girls, man. Getting a little sloppy now here.
Those aren't my cats. Whose cats are those?
I don't know, but there was some dude here feeding them the water.
They're probably over there at the behind us.
No, they're feeding them on the roof.
This used to be called the Old Corners, and it was the first tent bar during the gold rush that on this corner that sold a drink as a bar. Hmm. And you know, of course, Levi Strauss, the pants company, started right here. Because he originally came up here to make tents.
I make arrows. As you notice around here, his little projects here. Did you see the backside here? Now, what's the reality of anybody gonna see this back here?
See, what's really a thing that's so time-consuming is you're only moving up. You're only moving up 5 inches every time, you know what I'm saying? Where most roofing, you're moving 12 inches or more on shakes or 10, but it just gets a nail, two nails on each shingle. And you could use a staple gun and put, you know. We're not in a rush, and
what?
We're going to do it Fred Flintstone style.
Their plans scare me. My biggest problem is going to be keep my granddaughter and daughter from spending all their money in 1 week.